sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Outstanding product, great sales staff. Service department, outstanding. And the Friday show is always brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket, imports, domestics, microbrews, best selection of beer anywhere, wine coolers, waters, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. That pickle bar, led by the barrels and the dills, indeed, as always, second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. It is time now to go out and stock up for the weekend at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. All right, play-by-play call today. Football returned last night, and Al Michaels was on the call.
And Rippon to the end zone again. And it's going to be deflected and caught for the touchdown. Juwan Winfrey, sixth-round rookie, played his college ball at Colorado on a deflected pass, comes down with it to give them the lead with 1:26 to play.
Yeah, 14-10 was the final. Not exactly scintillating. And yes, they also did a replay for the first time last night on an interference play. I saw an article today that said, you know, to be honest with you, it just seemed normal the way they did it. Well, I don't care how normal the procedure is, but I'm getting sick of them stopping games. You know, the irony, Matt, is that last night I tuned in for only one series. I played golf until literally got dark. When I mean it literally got dark, I mean I hit a shot on a par 3 16th. And I hit it and thought, well, I thought I hit it pretty well, but I had no clue where it was. Zero. Okay. I felt good. So I went to the spot where maybe I thought I hit it, at least to the side I thought I hit it. And it turned out I was just off the green by a couple feet.
Well, then.
So I just had to chip up, putt, get a par, and leave.
Impressive in the dark, too.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean, I could look down and see the ball when I hit it. So
all right. Getting close to it, then.
I didn't have the thrill of watching the flight and going, oh, aren't I good? I didn't have. I just went, I don't know where that went. So I didn't get back until later, and then all right, Broncos are playing the Falcons. I'll watch the series. Okay. And that's the only series I saw, and they showed the replay. Oh, yeah, okay, it's not going to be Pat. Terry McCauley did a nice job explaining, whatever. But, Matt, it's another stop in the game. You have to stop inventing stops.
Reason why I wasn't in agreement with this new rule and for the fact that I didn't think there really was pass interference on that play, and they didn't get it right at all, whether right on the call right then and there or even on the replay. The guy barely touched. They touched each other barely. And the ball was overthrown. Plus, the guy, the receiver on the Falcons, stopped in his tracks.
But it's just another stoppage.
Right. I mean, that's the problem in itself, yeah. But it wasn't even worth it in this case.
The game. People want to see action. They don't want to see stops. The only time I want to see a stop is when my defense is out there and I want them to get a stop. It's the only stop I want to see. All right. Penn State football. Training camp gets underway in an hour. 55 minutes from now. I wonder if somebody might go. And we bring in Frank Bodani, York Daily Record. Frank, hello. Great to have you with us, my friend.
Great. How you guys doing? Ready for start of football and big meeting?
Here we go. The curtain is going to rise on the season. When you look at the Big Ten East, let's start there. Everyone knows who the Big Four happen to be. To you, is there a prohibitive favorite in this, or is it wide open?
Well, I mean, I guess Michigan would have the slight edge to me because you know more about what they're about. And I guess you'd start at quarterback. I think that has to give them the preseason edge. I mean, their defense has been good, unless they play Ohio State the past couple of years, like real good. So, the question had always been, strangely enough, on offense, but it almost seems like he's got a new coordinator. Of course, everybody Penn State familiar with him.
Sure.
Got plenty of talent on offense. You have a quarterback who you know about. That's been a weakness. They seem to have the most pieces in place. And then I think it becomes definitely more wide open after that.
All right, so now let's get to Penn State. Brent Pry has been a coordinator now for several years, and he's received justified praise for the job he's done. For Ricky Ronnie, it's going to be his second year as a coordinator. Do you expect to see from him a greater comfort level in the job, you know, growing each week as it goes along?
I would think he would have that, the greater comfort level. Now, how do we see that as a writer, a fan? That I don't know. You know, the thing about it is, it's the coach has that feeling and he's orchestrating what he wants, but the players have to carry it out in the end, and that's how ultimately the coordinator is judged by what the players do. So that connection between what he wants to do and what gets carried out on the field, man, I don't know. I think he has definitely has the most eyes on him, for sure. And maybe as coordinators go, maybe one of the guys that has the most eyes on him in the whole league, because it was a tough debut, not saying all the blame should go on his shoulders, but on debut for the offense last year. So what can you do now, you know?
How tough is it for any coordinator, though, when you do have, quote, we saw the number of drop passes, so it's yeah. That's no mystery. We all watched it. How tough is it when you're sitting there and your game plan says it should be second and two and it's second and ten?
Oh, I mean, I think that's why I would never want to be that job, right? I mean, because you only have so much control over things. But you know what? Since that Ricky not only loves what he's doing, but he so much wants to do well at it that it seems like he embraces that situation, everything about the job. I think that, hey, I think he's going to do well given enough time. Because, like you mentioned, the receivers last year, nobody saw that coming. And I would never think that that's Ricky Ronnie's necessarily his
right.
fault.
Of course not. Right.
Yeah, So you got to give somebody a fair chance, you know? I mean, so this is his fair chance. Things have to get better, whether it's, again, his fault or not. I think they have to improve this year on offense, or his seat's going to get hot. And that's just the nature of being the offensive coordinator at a place like Penn State, you know?
All right, so let's flip it over to the defense. A lot of people have talked about the team speed of this defense coming in. What are some of your expectations, if healthy, what they can do to then not only win games but also set up the offense?
Oh, I think, you know, with the speed and the talent that they have, the things in my mind are takeaways, you know, turnovers. They seem primed to be the type of defense that can make a big jump in that category, and then that helps everybody out. Big plays. I mean, turns games. If you look at the 1999 defense, you know, I mean, it didn't end up the way everybody wanted, but talk about the big plays.
Right.
You know, the capability that they had to turn games with LeVar Arrington and Courtney Brown. And I think that these guys might have that type of talent. It's just that it's still growing. So you hope that there's a lot more of that, especially around the front seven, I think. You know, everybody's looking to see what those athletic, fast linebackers could do, those defensive ends could do. So, yeah, turnovers to me, big thing.
Yeah. No, really, really big thing along the way. How do you view the depth? We know that we all watched how the transfer portal played out, and I think you and I are in agreement that where Penn State was hit in the transfer portal, not as extensively as people think, but still got hit maybe in the depth area. Do you still feel confident in the depth that you see on both sides of the ball?
Yeah, you just have to be confident in James Franklin's recruiting, because that's where a lot of the depth's going to come from, young guys that, you know, were pretty highly regarded and rated, and he's done a wonderful job recruiting the talent. It's just that the younger guys are going to have to be the depth now. And in this, I don't know, in this day and age, it's shifting and changing, and guys are leaving and they're not staying for, you know, their eligibility is not being used up, they're leaving early, they're switching teams. That seems perfectly normal to me that, hey, at this point, that's one of the reasons why you got to recruit great, because, hey, your depth is going to come from guys who haven't played a whole lot yet. So if you recruit the better ones, you have at least more options, right? And I think I don't know. In this day and age, I would not be concerned about that if I'm a Penn State fan. I think that looks pretty good.
Right. So I want to expand upon what you just talked about big picture-wise. You do have more players changing teams, or at the very least, it's more public. How about that? Mm-hmm. You have more players changing teams. Obviously, grad transfers, I think it's a different cat. But is it, you know, I'm not talking about, I want to take the individual off the table for a moment. Is it good for the game that you have this kind of movement?
You know, I guess I've, at least I'm, you know, covering football long enough to think of the way things were. So when you have a change that's like this, my first thought would be to say, well, I'm not necessarily good for the game. But I don't know if I even look at a lot of times anymore on, well, what's good for the game?
Right.
What does that even mean? I mean, it's a change, and you're going to have to adjust to it, and hopefully it doesn't make college football too much different that you can't enjoy it the way you wanted to in the past. So I don't think we're at that point. I don't know if it's good for the game. The only thing I would say is that, you know, growing up in the 70s and 80s, you know, one of the things you liked about, or I think I liked at that time about sports, is you would get to know teams. You get to know players because they were, whether they're in the pros or college, they were there long enough for you to get to know them. And that develops, you know, a familiarity. Then it helps you, I think, as a fan, because you're rooting for guys you knew played last year and the year before for your team. That's changing. So, yeah. You know, I guess in college, it's recruiting is such a big deal that I think at least fans get used to who kids are earlier than ever now, right? Because kids like Sean Clifford are committed to them for 2 years almost before they get to campus. They, you know, in this day and age, you can find out about who these guys are and maybe get a familiarity that way. Different. I never would have thought that, for example, some of Penn State's linemen would have left early as they did this year. That, right. You know, would that have happened 5 years ago, those types of kids? Right. I don't think so.
Probably not, which is the next part. I mean, does it still, for the most part, feel like watching college football to you, or do you feel because of some of the changes that there's inching their way toward a more pro look? As you know, in terms of feel for the fan.
Yeah, I think it's probably inching that way. To me, what separates college is the atmosphere. Okay, not even almost really what goes on the field during the game. It's everything about what happens before the game. It's the fans, the tailgating, the pageantry type of how it differs from every single college and how intense people get about it leading up to the game, because this is their university, this is their place. That's what's, I mean, that's the great part. I mean, as covering college football, I think that's why I really loved it. Covering college basketball, it's a different day of the week. It's in the wintertime, night. It's football's so different. Every Saturday in the fall, and if you have a game that's 3:30 or later, you know that you could get there if you wanted to 4 hours ahead and enjoy a whole nother part of it before the game begins. Adding a lot in most any other sport.
Yeah, exactly.
And you can't get it at every college football place either, but at Penn State, like, you can.
Right, exactly.
So as long as that doesn't change too much, to to me, at least, college football is still what college football is.
Penn State will play the opening three games at home, Idaho, Buffalo at night, then Pitt at noon, then get a bye week before the Big Ten opener at Maryland on that Friday night. What do you think Penn State, outside of obviously winning the games, but what does Penn State need to accomplish in those first three games that may answer some questions you have about the team?
I think continuity on offense, that's the first thing that comes to mind is, well, what does Penn State need to do this season? They need to grow on offense because you got a new quarterback, you have the problems with the receivers last year, and you have a lot of talent, but young kids. Somebody's got to step three and four receivers, so you need time to do that. Develop the continuity in game days between Clifford and Levis and those receivers. Mm-hmm. The offensive line, there's new people there. Offense is what jumps out to me, is that's what you need to work on to develop that continuity to me over the first 4 or 5 weeks. And it may take a while. I always think back to what would have been 2005 with Michael Robinson when he first came in. I think those first two or three or four games were at home.
Yeah.
You know, and at first people were not necessarily sold on that offense and that team and that quarterback the first few weeks. They needed time, and they took advantage of it. And so this is, to me, a kind of similar situation.
Yeah, in fact, it was that Big Ten opener they played at Northwestern. I think that started to sway people as to what kind of team they could be when they were able to get that late drive.
Not before that, Steve, in the game. Man, it's like you were up there. I mean, thank God they could score points, but you were just up there thinking, are they going to hold on to the football? Is this ever going to get cleaned up? And then,
right. Like
you said, it clicked, kind of, but it took them a while.
Yeah, it took them a while, and then after that, then they had that big win over Minnesota, and then that set up the Ohio State game, and we know what happened after that. Joe Lord comes in, and his job is special teams. We know he has a great reputation. What can be done to make special teams for Penn State a difference maker, in your opinion?
Well, I think it's the most overlooked, probably change and most overlooked aspect of this team, because I think from reading about him and kind of making sure you kind of go back to concentrate on special teams and the effect they can have, because you kind of lose that track of that sometimes, I think it make a huge difference. And this guy comes in with a big reputation for changing things around. I mean, I don't think Penn State has still been able to get everything they can out of their return game yet. I mean, they've done better, obviously.
Sure.
But I still think there's more potential to be used, and he seemed like, at least where he was at before, he was great at getting that. And I think Penn State has now more speed than ever, more athleticism and talent. So get more out of the return game even more than you are. That's a big thing. And I guess being more consistent on some of the other special teams will probably not help people with big splash type of things, but will overall be an underlying kind of difference maker that you don't always realize. Like, I expect Blake Gillikin to be much more consistent this year.
Agreed.
And the punt team. And I think that's not going to jump out at people, but it's going to make a big difference if you look back here and there. Same with your kicking game. More consistency will make a little bit of a difference here, a little bit of a difference there, and it will add up. And if you're that consistent and strong and don't make mistakes, I think that's what last year to me was, is that not that they were bad on special teams. They were so inconsistent and just made mistakes that too many at the wrong times.
Frank, always a pleasure. Always appreciate your time, my friend.
Oh. Yeah, excellent. I look forward to seeing you tomorrow.
Absolutely. I look forward to seeing you as well.
Have a great one.
You
too.
Take
care.
Frank Bodani, York Daily Record, back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Brewers Outlet.
Brewers Outlet, the beverage superstock superstores, ready for all of your warm weather activities. Camping, picnics, grilling, visit Brewers Outlet first. For microbrews, imports, domestic specialties, they got them. Grab some pickles at the Pickle Bar, Steve Jones's favorite place. Snacks, Brewers Outlet has that covered. Soda, sports drinks, check. Weekly specials, too. And there's lots of convenient parking. So get all the refreshments everyone will love for your next outdoor gathering at Brewers Outlet, the beverage superstock superstore, Reagan Street, Sunbury.
Great to have you with us. Plenty to talk about in the final half hour and a lot on Penn State football that we'll discuss. Looking forward to that. Today's show brought to you by our good friends at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Imports, domestics, microbrews, best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drink, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day in the pickle bar. Led by the barrels of the Dills, indeed second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Brewer.
And we just had a brief power outage here at our Sunbury Broadcasting Studios at the top of Blue Hill, so we apologize for the technical difficulties. We will get back to Steve in just 1 second from the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We're talking with Frank Bodani of the York Daily Record on the what's going on with Penn State camp. Transfer, very interesting conversation, as we talked about before. Rick Slade and Journey Brown, T.J. Holmes mentioned, and those guys at the running back position. We'll see how that goes. And Steve talked about a lot of different things that he I was about to say, Steve, yeah, we just had a brief power outage here. We have a thunderstorm coming through, but I was about to say, you and Frank mentioned a lot of things you're excited about. I know you're excited about the team in general, but for me, when I look at this team, the defense and some of the names that are coming back, I mean, you look at the linebacking core, you look at some of the guys on the defensive line, and of course you have John Reed back in the secondary. I think... Penn State's defense is really going to have to carry the weight this year for an offense that's got a lot of new parts coming in.
You're going to need some people, though, to step up. All right, so let's start with this. Micah Parsons, known entity. Now, can Micah Parsons be better? Yes. Now, he's had a year of playing linebacker under his belt. He's had a year of playing in space. And as the season went last year, he got better and better. But Jesse Lucchetta is an important depth piece on this team. Very important. He's going to play. And with him playing, that means he's got to step up and he's got to give them the depth where you can buy, for example, Cam Brown some time. And Cam Brown can be fresh in the fourth quarter because of what Lucchetta has done in a couple of other quarters. You need Ellis Brooks, who I thought played very well last year, to make the next step and continue to play well behind Jan Johnson. You're going to need P.J. Mustipher, who will probably start this camp as a two behind Antonio Shelton, to make the next step and be better where there's no drop-off when he's in the game. You're going to need Shane Simmons, who has been injury-plagued in his Penn State career but has a wealth of talent, to be the kind of guy that is dependable and out there every single day to give you more depth at defensive end. I think an underrated guy at defensive end that nobody really talks about, that I think if you spot him well enough can really play really well for you, is Daniel Joseph. Owe, to me, is more of a known entity to some fans than Daniel Joseph is. And Owe has a chance to be a terrific player. Being an every down guy, Shaka Tony, he'll need to do well. And then I want to see what Jaquan Brisker does to be potentially that fourth safety. When you get to offense, again, to me, a lot of these guys are known entities. To you, the fan, they are not really. You've heard about Daniel Joseph. And again, that's the advantage. I get to see them literally every day. Justin Shorter, you get to see him literally every day. So you know where he was and the progress he's made along the way. That's why it's always interesting when I hear comments from the outside and even sometimes you hear comments from the outside from maybe a person being recruited, and you sit back and say, I was there every day. That's not quite accurate. Okay. All right. A little tougher for me to take as I'm standing there and saying, that's not quite right. I can't really talk about it, but that's not quite right. Shorter's going to be a really good player, I think. Now, who else can emerge? Now, the running backs, obviously, with Barkley and Lynch, when Saquon was a freshman. No offense to Akeel Lynch, but you could see right away Barkley was, I've always told the story about after the second practice, Jack called, he says, hey, what have you seen so far? And I said, you got to see this Barkley kid. He's unbelievable. Right? And so Jack gets there and goes, holy my goodness. And he hardly played in the Temple game. And then after that, they started inserting him more. And then Miles Sanders was recruited. And Miles Sanders' credit, I think, looked around at Barkley and went, ooh. But then he had his shot. So you really have not had what you would call a situation like this with multiple running backs at once. I mean, the bottom line is, in Barkley's 3 years, for the most part, Barkley was the guy taking the vast majority of the snaps by a wide margin. Maybe, with an ankle injury and with Lynch around his freshman year, Barkley still took most of the snaps, but obviously the percentage was lower compared to his sophomore and junior seasons. Sanders took the vast majority of snaps last year. Slay got a few, no question. Journey got a few, no question. But now this is a year that with four running backs, I think the door is open for all four to play. Now, maybe the idea will be to take one of the freshmen and crush the red shirt and just play him and redshirt the other guy. I don't know. I would not be surprised if all four got in there because all four are different. Slade has some speed. Slade has good hands. I think after struggling as a blocker last year, I think he's become a better blocker. We know Journey Brown's got speed. What's underrated about Journey Brown is I think he actually runs pretty well between the tackles. I think his stamina is now better. Kane has a fabulous low center of gravity. I mean, if Kane breaks past the second level and he gets into the secondary, could Kane be caught from behind? Hey, might be. But his ability to get to that third level, he can get there. And he's got that low center of gravity. He's a tough guy to tackle, tough guy to bring down, very balanced when he runs. And Devin Ford's the guy I want to look at. I've heard great things about him. I've never once seen him carry the ball. Okay? First time I'll ever watch him carry the ball will be an hour from now.
How about C.J. Holmes?
C.J. Holmes.
I know he's the Notre Dame transfer.
Yeah. C.J. Holmes, I think, is going to get a look at the safety spot.
Oh, okay.
I think that is where he'll get his first look in camp, and then we'll go from there. He did a good job on scout team last year. Did a good job. I mean, I'm not going to say great. I just like he did a good job. And that's... So we'll see what happens with him. But those are the four primary guys, I think, going in at the running back spot. And, you know, obviously there's going to be a lot of focus on Clifford and Levis. That's the reason why. I mean, the Clifford-Levis thing is the reason why you don't have more people jumping on the Penn State bandwagon. Not because it's Clifford and Levis. It's because nobody knows anything about them. Simple as that. When you're doing your preseason ratings about teams, how often do you look at, what's the first thing you look at when you look at a team and your preseason rankings? You look at, do they have a returning quarterback? Now, Alabama's great to begin with, but they got Tua Tagovailoa back. Clemson's great to begin with. They got Trevor Lawrence back. Georgia's really good to begin with. Oh, they got Jake Fromm back. Notre Dame's not bad. They got Ian Book back. Right? A lot of people have been touting Michigan. They got Shea Patterson back. Very rare when you get into an Oklahoma situation like a year ago, where they did not have the returning starter quarterback, but a lot of people were very high on Kyler Murray when the season began. And then Murray took advantage of his one season, and he won the Heisman Trophy, and then he ended up being the first overall pick in the draft. Usually teams that have returning quarterbacks, Texas is highly thought of this year. Erling is back. A lot of people think Michigan State can make a move up from 7-6. They've got Brian Lewerke back. It's very rare when a team doesn't have the starting quarterback back and is highly regarded. Penn State received more juice a year ago because they had Trace McSorley back as the for the third year as the starting quarterback. So when the quarterback is, quote, an unknown entity, end quote, then you're not going to get the same kind of preseason run. And again, I go back to what I do. I'm in a different spot, and being in a different spot, I've watched Clifford play for 2 years at quarterback. I've watched Levis play for 1 year at quarterback. Thus, that's what I have no worries about, none, about them playing quarterback. Now, there are going to be certain elements that they'll need to handle as a game goes, which also as a season goes. You go through a couple of three and outs. You're seeing pressure from maybe a side you didn't expect to see, or you're seeing a coverage you didn't expect to see. How do you adjust to it? Do you adjust? We have to see that. 2 minutes to go in the half. Got to put together a drive. All right. I've seen you do it in practice repeatedly. I've seen Clifford do it how many times in practice? To a lesser extent, I've seen Will Levis do it, but I've seen Clifford do it many times in practice. Okay. How does he handle it in the game? Same thing with the end of the game. Yeah, a couple minutes ago in the game, got to win it. Can you find a way? Those are all questions going in that just can't be answered until you play games. But in terms of the ability, in terms of the ability to run, the judgment to run, how he throws a football, Clifford's got all that. I've seen that for 2 years. Levis, size, strength, can run, powerful arm. But if you are not around this every day, like I'm around it every day, and you know, the beat writers have seen plenty. But I'm talking about national entities. If you're writing a national magazine or you're writing a national column, you're not going to be in here seeing these guys. And if you do, you're coming in for one practice, go, okay, and then you move on. Okay. That's why if I want to, he's on WMLP, Rush Limbaugh, right? Refers to it as the, quote, drive-by media. Well, that is, it may be a cute way of saying it, but that is what they are. They pop in for a practice, think they've got all the answers, and leave. Or they don't pop into any practice and have all the answers. It's always love that. And I think, all right, okay, great. That's why I don't hang on every word that they say. And I always find it curious that some people do. I think you got to be around it all the time to really know it. I mean, that's just me. I just think you have to. I think it's just... The anytime you get a bigger sample size of anything, you get better answers. I think you get limited answers when the sample size is small.
Go. I was in Chicago for a wedding,
and
I got a chance to finally see Wrigley Field.
Yeah. What'd you think?
Awesome. Really cool place.
Yeah. I've only seen it. I've never gone in there.
Yeah, I didn't physically go in either because the game was already done. That was the Padres series. They had all afternoon games, but went by, took a couple pictures, walked around the stadium. Yeah, not bad.
Wow. That's really cool. I like that a lot. So let's see. Was it Chris Peterson put out a tweet today? Penn State Athletics wishes to provide an opportunity for one Pennsylvania high school football game to be played in Beaver Stadium this fall.
I did see this,
working with the appropriate officials regarding the details. Now, in 1988, they played the Quad A championship game in Beaver Stadium. And I think they had like 10,000 people there. But the problem is when you get 10,000 people in there, it doesn't look like anybody's in there. It looks like the usher staff. That's the problem. I mean, that's one of the reasons, for example, I've talked about this before. You know, Selins Grove won the state baseball championship in Medlar Field, Lebrano Park. One of the reasons the PIAA loves Medlar Field, Lebrano Park. You know, obviously, it's a first-class facility. It's really, really nice. But it's also the right size for what they're doing. It's 5,570 seats. So you get 3,000, 4,000 people in there, it looks almost full. And they like that. Today's show has been brought to you by our good friends at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the Beverage Supermarket. Stock up now. Imports, domestics, microbrews. Best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. And the pickle bar, led by the barrels and the dills, indeed second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the Beverage Supermarket. We'll be back with you Monday in the Sunbury Motors Studio.